Harper Audio presents Choice Theory, A New Psychology of Personal Freedom, by William Glasser, M.D., read by John Maher.
Preface. This book is about how important good relationships are to a successful life. In it, I state that if we are not sick, poverty-stricken, or suffering the ravages of old age, the major human problems we struggle with, violence, crime, child abuse, spousal abuse, alcohol and drug addiction, the proliferation of premature and unloving sex and emotional distress are caused by unsatisfying relationships. This whole book is both an explanation of why this happens and what to do to get along better with one another. I focus on four major relationships, all of which are in obvious need of improvement. These are husband-wife, parent-child, teacher-student, and manager-worker. I make the claim that if we do not improve these relationships, we will have little success in reducing any of the problems in the previous paragraph. For me to make such a broad claim may be considered presumptuous, but just before this book went to press, I was pleased to find recent research that strongly supports my thesis that adolescents especially need good parent-child and teacher-student relationships if they are to avoid self-destructive behaviors. The September 10, 1997 issue of the Journal of the American Medical Association, JAMA, includes an article entitled Protecting Adolescents from Harm, which describes the first findings from the National Longitudinal Study on Adolescent Health. The most significant finding was parent-family connectedness and perceived school connectedness were protective of every health risk behavior measure except history of pregnancy. The research does not as yet go into how to improve these two important relationships, but it does show clearly that this is the direction in which to go, and that is the subject of this book. I would suggest that the researchers also focus on how husbands and wives can achieve more marital satisfaction, which I think is a vital factor in achieving child-parent connectedness. Years ago, a priest I knew in Chicago by the name of Father John said something I have never forgotten. The best thing parents can do for their children is love each other. As you read this book, you will note that I do not use the word connectedness. Although I use satisfying relationships, I can see no difference in the terms. I encourage you to read the JAMA article if you want to see for yourself how strongly it supports what I say in this book. Acknowledgements. When I got started on the wrong track, Bob Sulo did a lot of thinking helping me straighten out. I probably would have gotten there eventually, but I appreciate very much what he did. His book, Inspiring Quality in Your School, discusses how a lot of choice theory is put to practical use in a school. Bob Wibolding, a colleague of 25 years, made some good suggestions throughout. His expertise is reality therapy, and he is in the process of writing a new book, Reality Therapy for the 21st Century. Among the things he'll do in this book is answer all the people who question whether there is a research base for this therapy. There is. Kay Mentley, mentioned in depth in Chapter 10, is the principal of the first quality elementary school, Huntington Woods, that is choice theory from floor to ceiling. Put together every fantasy about what a school should be. Kay and her staff have brought them to life. Her book, Quality is the Key, Stories from Huntington Woods, is available from the William Glasser Institute. Linda Harshman, the director of the William Glasser Institute, made it possible for me to have the time to write this book. She is a lead manager. Talk to any of our staff, and you will quickly see why. To me, she is indispensable. If you found that the book reads easily and clearly, I thank Cynthia Merman, my editor. When I sent her the manuscript, I said, "Work your magic." She did. Brian Lennon, from Skerries near Dublin, Ireland, gave me the support I needed when my editor faxed me while I was in Slovenia to tell me that the book was great, but that it needed a new subtitle. He helped to steer me in the right direction, but my many Slovenian and Croatian colleagues also did their part. When we asked, "What does choice theory mean to you?" they said, "Freedom." Recently, at a conference in Acapulco, I had the pleasure of meeting a caring brain researcher, S. Paul Rossby, who presented a paper on the neurophysiology of violence. When my wife and I talked to him afterward, tears came to his eyes when we told him we believe that violence is not irreversibly imprinted into the brains of many young people who seem so callous and hard to reach. With caring and choice theory, their violence can be reversed. We look forward to sharing ideas with him again. If you want to reach any of these people for any reason, and they are well worth reaching, contact the William Glasser Institute for their addresses. They helped me, and I'm sure they would not hesitate to help you. I have to stop here. If I went on, I might not be able to stop short of the hundreds of people teaching choice theory who are joining me in the task of driving the plague of external control psychology from the earth. Part 1. The Theory. Chapter 1. We need a new psychology. Suppose you could ask all the people in the world who are not hungry, sick, or poor, people who seem to have a lot to live for, to give you an honest answer to the question, "How are you?" Millions would say, "I'm miserable." If asked why, almost all of them would blame someone else for their misery: lovers, wives, husbands, exes, children, patients, teachers, students, or people they work with. There is hardly a person alive who hasn't been heard saying, "You're driving me crazy. That really upsets me. Don't you have any consideration for how I feel? You make me so mad I can't see straight." It never crosses their minds that they are choosing the misery they are complaining about. Choice theory explains that, for all practical purposes, we choose everything we do, including the misery we feel. Other people can neither make us miserable nor make us happy. All we can get from them or give to them is information. But by itself, information cannot make us do or feel anything. It goes into our brains, where we process it and then decide what to do. As I explain in great detail in this book, we choose all our actions and thoughts, and indirectly, almost all our feelings and much of our physiology. As bad as you may feel, much of what goes on in your body when you are in pain or sick is the indirect result of the actions and thoughts you choose or have chosen every day of your life. I also show how and why we make these painful, even crazy choices, and how we can make better ones. Choice theory teaches that we are much more in control of our lives than we realize. Unfortunately, much of that control is not effective. For example, you choose to feel upset with your child, then you choose to yell and threaten, and things get worse, not better. Taking more effective control means making better choices as you relate to your children and everyone else. You can learn through choice theory how people actually function, how we combine what is written in our genes with what we learn as we live our lives. The best way to learn choice theory is to focus on why we choose the common miseries that we believe just happen to us. When we are depressed, we believe that we have no control over our suffering, that we are victims of an imbalance in our neurochemistry, and hence that we need brain drugs, such as Prozac, to get our chemistry back into balance. Little of this belief is true. We have a lot of control over our suffering. We are rarely the victims of what happened to us in the past, and, as will be explained in Chapter 4, our brain chemistry is normal for what we are choosing to do. Brain drugs may make us feel better, but they do not solve the problems that led us to choose to feel miserable. The seeds of almost all our unhappiness are planted early in our lives, when we begin to encounter people who have discovered not only what is right for them, but also, unfortunately, what is right for us. Armed with this discovery and following a destructive tradition that has dominated our thinking for thousands of years, these people feel obligated to try to force us to do what they know is right. Our choice of how we resist that force is, by far, the greatest source of human misery. Choice theory challenges this ancient, "I know what's right for you" tradition. This entire book is an attempt to answer the all-important question that almost all of us continually ask ourselves when we are unhappy. How can I figure out how to be free to live my life the way I want to live it and still get along well with the people I need? From the perspective of 40 years of psychiatric practice, it has become apparent to me that all unhappy people have the same problem. they are unable to get along well with the people they want to get along well with. I have had many counseling successes, but I keep hearing my mentor, Dr. G.L. Harrington, the most skillful psychiatrist I've ever known, saying, "If all the professionals in our field suddenly disappeared, the world would hardly note their absence." He was not disparaging what we do. He was saying that if the goal of psychiatrists is to reduce the misery rampant in the world and to help human beings get along with each other, their efforts have hardly scratched the surface. To begin to approach that goal, we need a new psychology that can help us get closer to each other than most of us are able to do now. The psychology must be easy to understand so it can be taught to anyone who wants to learn it. And it must be easy to use once we understand it. Our present psychology has failed. We do not know how to get along with each other any better than we ever have. Indeed, the psychology we have embraced tends to drive us apart. In the area of marriage alone, it is clear that the use of this traditional psychology has failed. I call this universal psychology that destroys relationships because it destroys personal freedom, external control psychology. The control can be as slight as a disapproving glance or as forceful as a threat to our lives, but whatever it is an attempt to force us to do what we may not want to do. We end up believing that other people can actually make us feel the way we feel or do the things we do. This belief takes away the personal freedom we all need and want. The simple operational premise of the external control psychology the world uses is, punish the people who are doing wrong, so they will do what we say is right, then reward them, so they keep doing what we want them to do. This premise dominates the thinking of most people on Earth. What makes this psychology so prevalent is that those who have the power, agents of government, parents, teachers, business managers, and religious leaders who also define what's right or wrong, totally support it. And the people they control, having so little control over their own lives, find some security in accepting the control of these powerful people. It is unfortunate that almost no one is aware that this controlling, coercing, or forcing psychology is creating the widespread misery that, as much as we have tried, we have not yet been able to reduce. This misery continues unabated, not because we have thought it over and decided that controlling others is best. It continues because when people do not do what we want them to do, coercion and control are all we think of using. It is the psychology of our ancestors, our parents and grandparents, of our teachers and leaders, of almost all the people we know or know about. Coercion, to try to get our way, has been with us so long that it is considered common sense, and we use it without thinking about it. We neither care where it came from nor question its validity. If external control is the source of so much misery, why is it the choice of almost all people, even powerless people, who suffer so much from it? The answer is simple. It works. It works for the powerful because it often gets them what they want. It works for the powerless because they experience it working on them and live in hope that they will eventually be able to use it on someone else. The lowest people on the totem pole look up more than they look down. But even more so, the powerless accept it because, as miserable as they may be, they believe that they are not free to choose otherwise. They further believe, usually correctly, that to resist would be worse. So, one way or another, most people are doing many things they don't want to do. For example, many women stay in abusive marriages because they think leaving would be worse. Alone, they fear they would be unable to support themselves, lose their children, might still suffer abuse, and maybe risk their lives. Many continually entertain the hope that if they stick it out, things will get better. But this book is about much more than why people stay and accept external control. It is about the fact that the belief in and use of external control harms everyone, both the controllers and the controlled. For example, the abusive husband also suffers, though not as much as his wife and family. He, too, is a victim of external control psychology. In choosing to do what he does, he loses any chance for happiness. This psychology is a terrible plague that invades every part of our lives. It destroys our happiness, our health, our marriages, our families, our ability to get an education, and our willingness to do high-quality work. It is the cause of most of the violence, crime, drug abuse, and unloving sex that are pervasive in our society. This book is all about this human toll and how it can be reduced by both learning why external control is so harmful and how a new pro-relationship theory can replace it. Choice theory is an internal control psychology. It explains why and how we make the choices that determine the course of our lives. Choice theory is a complete change from what has been common sense to what I hope will become, in time, a new common sense. This change is not easy. It can happen only through learning what is wrong with external control psychology and the overwhelming reasons to replace it with choice theory as we deal with the people in our lives. As we attempt to do this, we will continually ask ourselves, will what I am about to do bring me closer to these people or move us further apart? How we use this basic question and what would be possible if we did are the heart and soul of this book. What I do in this book is question the basic psychology of the world, and I have no illusions that it is an easy task, to begin to realize the existence of this psychology and how harmful it is to our lives. We need to take a look at some of the misery we suffer because we depend on our common sense even when it becomes apparent that it isn't working. For example, using the only psychology you know, you punish your teenage son for not doing his schoolwork by grounding him on weekends. But after you ground him, he still doesn't do his homework, and to make matters worse, you have a sullen teenager hanging around the house all weekend. After a month, you begin to think, why am I doing this over and over? There must be a better way. It may take a while to come to this realization because punishing your son is so much a part of your common sense that it doesn't feel like a choice. It feels right. It's what a good parent does in this situation. It's probably what your parents did to you, and you are supported by everyone you ask. Giving you the benefit of an almost universal common sense, they say, punish him. Why are you asking me this stupid question? Do you want him to grow up to be a bum? The only problem with this advice is that it rarely succeeds. As you continue to punish your son, he and you stop talking and listening to each other. You are both miserable, you blame each other for how you feel, and he does less schoolwork than before. Still, for most people, the idea of going against common sense, especially in how they deal with their children, is a new and troubling idea. But assuming you would like to have less misery in your life, you may be open to learning why controlling and allowing yourself to be controlled are so destructive to the relationships you need to be happy. Then, you may be willing to try choice theory in some situations in which attempting to control has been ineffective. If it works better, and my 20 years of experience with choice theory argue that it will, you may want to begin the difficult process of discarding external control and replacing it with choice theory. Psychologies, even common sense, ancient psychologies, should be discarded if they damage relationships. To convince you that we should give up external control psychology, I have included a simple graph that compares two kinds of progress, technical progress and human progress. Such a comparison is unusual because when we think of progress, the progress that comes to mind is technical because, as the graph shows, this progress is so obvious. We rarely think of human progress, which is getting along with each other better than we have in the past, because we haven't seen or read about enough people getting along that much better with each other to begin to think there has been much progress in this area. In the past 100 years, there has been considerable technical progress. We have moved from the first airplane to the supersonic jet to exploring Mars. Communication has gone from the turn-the-crank phone to the internet. The list is endless. Not so with human progress. Except for some improvements in civil rights in the 1960s and some recent movement toward better relationships between managers and workers since quality management surfaced in the 1970s, we are no more able to get along well with each other than we ever were. Can anyone say that there has been any improvement in how husbands and wives get along with each other? Are families in better shape today than years ago? If they are, it's news to me. I work in schools, and I have yet to hear a teacher say that things are better now than when he or she started teaching. Actually,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.